happen again in our life. We face that probably in our day-to-day lives also. And we have probably dealt with them also in the past. So uncertainty is nothing but imperfect or unknown information, and it applies to a lot of prediction of future events, to physical measurements, or to the unknown. Then what is certainty? It is firm conviction. This is the case. How many of us can relate to the idea of certainty? Do you believe that certainty in any possibility is possible? I would like you all to reflect on this point. Is certainty possible? You may send in your replies on the message or the question and answer box out there. Is certainty possible according to you all? While you answer, I would also like to move forward, and I would reply to that question towards the end of our PPT. All right, we will have a look at these answers. Now, I would like to talk about what is different now from the uncertain situations that we face in our day-to-day life. So generally, uncertainty would be, you know, the climatic changes that we go through, you know, probably a rain in the month of December in India, in a city like Mumbai, would be very uncertain for us. Going to college, reaching late, being punished by our teachers, or reaching late to work, having a salary cut, they are uncertain because it's not something that happens very often with us. So probably, you know, something happens while I'm reaching to college. Maybe I miss the bus. Very uncertain, right? So uncertainty is about that. But right now, the situation is different because it's COVID-19. It's large, it's global, it's much more difficult to handle, all right? So it's very collective as humans, for all of us across the globe, that we are feeling this uncertainty, where we are really upset about the safety. You know, are we going to be safe? Are the loved ones going to be safe? You know, we're surrounded by it completely. And we are fearing about it, that, you know, the life of our loved ones, the life of ourselves, and how we will go about these times. You know, will life ever be back to how it used to be? Will I be able to travel again? Will I be able to, you know, go to my school, my college, my workplace, all of this? So yes, it is different right now because it's much more collective, and it is going to be probably a very long time till we really know of how can it be dealt with. We don't know when the vaccines are going to be out. We don't know what is the right treatment for it yet. So a lot of questions in our head, and therefore, of course, yes, COVID-19 and this time of uncertainty is quite different. Now, COVID-19 has hit us, and it has hit us hard financially, physically, family, and emotionally. These are the grounds where COVID-19 has hit us hard, and let us explore these areas. Of course, you may be really aware and you may relate with it right now. Make mental notes about it, all right? Because as we go down and towards the section of self-care, definitely you will find out ways of guidance on guiding yourself of how you can deal and manage with the situation better. Now, financially, there's loss of jobs everywhere. You know, if you see around you, there are a lot of people who are upset because they've lost their jobs. They've lost hope. What will happen? What is my future going to be like? There have been salary cuts out there. Businesses are being pulled down because, you know, everything is shut down. And especially in India, because of lockdown situation, you know, the businesses weren't running at all. There is a global economic crisis. We are facing it. People are not left with savings. They were surviving all this while with their savings. There's been professional isolation. And I think all of us have been hit very hard with that, not being able to meet our colleagues face to face, you know, having our daily meetings, the greetings. You know, a lot of personal touch is being missing out on the professional front also. So yes, there's been a financial loss out there, which is very, very strong. The next is physically. How many of us have been affected by sleep? Sleep because of the stress of how we will cope up. You know, when will we be back to work? you know, is there enough and sufficient savings for us to survive, you know, having to, or wanting to, you know, about education, like how will my education go ahead? I'm stuck at home. You know, will it be possible from the field that I belong to for me to study from home? You know, if your exams are stuck, yes, it's a big time where, you know, at least in Mumbai, people have been upset with not exactly knowing whether they'll have their exams or not. So yes, sleep is being affected for various reasons. And one of the top reasons is also because we have been busy with our video games or the mobile games, playing, binge playing or watching Netflix, or, you know, for continuously for hours and hours and binge watching them and not keeping up with the sleep cycle. Another reason is exercise. So if you are someone who is accustomed to going to gym, need your the instruments which are there at the gym machines, or those who are people who need a trainer or a guide to help them exercise, then yes, it's been tough on them. Also, with the lockdown which was there earlier, when we couldn't move out for walk and for our jogs, yes, it was hit hard. The next is nutrition. So for all those who not followed their daily routine or patterns of their eating times, so if you're not eating at the same time, you know, it is going to affect your immunity. Also, not eating healthy, all right, is also something that can be affected. And if you are really upset and you don't feel like eating, so if you're not regulating your eating hours and your eating habits, it's going to affect you physically. The next is family. Now, family is time to bond. And are you bonding? It's a very big question. You know, our family time is the time to bond with each other. Or are you ended up in, you know, fights? Fights because there's lack of space, you know, space of being around each other. We are very used to having our space distributed well, where we are at home, then at work, and then back home. And, you know, we have space from each other, which we're used to. So, you know, how is it at home? Are you spending time with each other? Are you busy in your respective rooms or watching TV or Netflix and, you know, not even interacting with each other? Or is it also going to, it is also going to affect you if the space in your house is very small, and therefore because of which, you know, I want to watch this channel on TV and that channel on TV, and I don't want to watch TV, I want to sleep right now. These can be little things that you're fighting on. And last thing under family would be like, are you talking healthy? Are you talking about how the prospects of, you know, how we're going to deal with the times that are going to come forward, you know, now that we're getting back to work out here? You know, how are we going to deal with it? Are these healthy discussions taking place in the family? So yes, family time is one area where it can be affected, because there are families out there, probably they're not having food to eat. There are family out there, probably, you know, the walls, they're living in the four walls, and it can be claustrophobic for people because they're getting to move out. So all of these factors coming forward is emotionally. Now, how many of y'all feel emotionally drained because of this? You know, ask this question to yourself, monitor yourself, and ask yourself, what are you doing about it? All right. Now, let us understand on emotional grounds, how is it affecting us? Number one, grief. So, unfortunately, if there has been a loss in your house or in your neighborhood owing to COVID-19 or any other condition, it can lead to intense grief. And grief in these hours can be very, very intense also, because we cannot go and meet that relative of ours, you know, and probably have people come in to share the grief with us. So yes, it's been tough times to all those people, you know, for them, unfortunately, where there have been a loss of life in their families. Also, there's something called as anticipatory grief, which is seen in times of uncertainty. It is a feeling that one gets about the future that they're holding. It usually centers around death, but however, I would like to share out here that it's not just around that, but anticipatory grief about what if I lose my job? What if I have to shut my business? You know, will I be getting my salary? How things will turn around? You know, all of these questions are arising, and you know, the grief is in your mind because if I lose this job, I won't be meeting the people I meet every day. I will not be getting to do the work I've been doing every day. There's already a halt for a lot of people in the work they are doing. So yes, that is also in place. Another thing is denial, and this is something that we will observe around, as I have observed around me, where people have been facing issues like, you know, I cannot have this problem, it cannot happen to me, this is not possible. All right, I'm not the one who will get the COVID-19. I cannot get the coronavirus. I will not go for the checkup if I'm unwell. It must be just a normal flu. All right, so there's a lot of denial in people that what is happening can happen to us as human beings. All right, of course, there is sadness which comes across because of the grief, because of everything that has just changed suddenly. There's a change in the plans that we've had, you know, all of that is something that we are affected by. Another thing is anger. And how many of us are feeling this anger and resulting into something called this blame game out here? You know, a lot of us probably are ending up in doing that, that it is because of a certain community, a certain country, that this is happening to us. You know, it is because of their mistake, it's because of their fault, they purposely did it to us. There have been theories that have been coming out of it, there have been murders because of this. So yes, there's a lot of anger in people. We had plans for the year and these plans have been cancelled. I so hate these people because of whom we are suffering. There is anger, all right? There is anger because we are not making the money we used to make. There is anger because we are not going to work the way we used to go. There is anger because there is a sense of loss of creativity that we were so used to engaging into the work of knowledge, since most of us are from the field of education. Yes, going to college every day, meeting our students every day, you know, meeting our teachers, our staff, our colleagues. There's a lot of anger out there. The next is guilt. And this guilt is something because, you know, for example, if by chance someone has caught the virus, oh, you know, I made the mistake, probably I should not have touched my face, I should not have touched my eyes, or I shouldn't have gone out of house, I shouldn't have started work since work is started, I shouldn't have gone for the walk, oh, I did such a big mistake, or someone got the virus, because of me, and they are serious, critical, living in guilt. So there's a lot of guilt. There's also guilt because how will I take care of my family? I'm the person responsible for my family. Is that going to be possible? So yes, guilt is something we're engulfed with, or this possibility of it coming to us. Fear, of course, I think this is something which has been a very highly collective sense amongst us. I don't want the virus. Yeah, there's a lot of fear. What if I get the virus? What if someone in my family gets it? What if someone dies because of it? What if someone is critical? Will I be able to meet my people? So there's a lot of fear within us. And finally, yes, we are all in a shock, because 5 to 6 months ago, none of us thought that this could happen to us. None of us could believe that this could happen to us. We are being in shock because of this, you know. And I think with time, we are overcoming it. We are learning to live with it. But yes, it's been a big, big and a huge shock factor for us. Now, I would come on to the next slide, where we will talk about the psychological impacts. It is the result of the above factors not managed during uncertain times. So if I'm not able to manage my emotions, my anger, all right, I'm going to have these emotions. It's not that to have these emotions is something wrong. It's very normal for us to feel sad. It's very normal for us to be angry. But how do I manage these emotions? That's very, very important. And when I'm not able to manage these, yes, psychologically, I am going to be impacted. And how is that going to happen? Number one is anxiety. Number two is stress, and number three is depression. Now, we have been anxious for a long, long time because we've not known, all right, that when will the vaccine come? We are waiting for it. We've been anxious about the fact that we will be getting back to work. We have become used to being living with our family members unless we've been frontline workers. So yes, there's a lot of anxiety amongst us. Anxiety of what if I catch this virus? There is this fear which will lead to this anxiety. All right. There is this fear that is going to create this anxiousness amongst us. And if we are not able to deal with it with a very healthy self-talk, anxiety can lead to a bigger problem which can become a disorder. So anxiety is something we all face, but if it becomes deeper and stronger and more in intensity, then yes, we can develop a major problem because of this anxiety. The next is stress. And I think we all have been stressed. Stress about all the above factors that I mentioned before. You know, we've been stressed because we do not know how to deal with this problem. We've been stressed because, you know, we don't know for how long we will survive on our savings. We've been stressed because we don't know whether we'll be able to complete our portion and give out to the students all the required training the way we used to do. So there's been this confusion and this stress, you know, the confusion leading to this stress, and it's been a major issue. The next is depression. Sleep problems, loss of appetite, not wanting to talk to people, isolating yourself, and maybe covering it all up with a mask and a huge smile, but not being able to connect to our inner self. These are all signs of depression. And if we do not manage to socialize well and be around with people and talk healthy about these things, yes, this is what can happen to all of us. Come to a point of what can we do. But before that, I would like you to all reflect on what I have spoken about as of now. And, you know, if you all have any doubts, note them down, all right? Because when I will be going to the next part of the slide, all right, the next part of the PPT, that is what can we do, all right? You can have a lot of reflection and introspection take place of where you are now and what you can add to your life for you know, making it a better space and less distressful. We need to understand. And what we need to understand is different people respond differently to the same situation. If I am of the kind of personality who loves adventure in life, all right, who goes about doing different things all the time, who takes risks in life, this uncertain time is something probably I will manage to handle better than people who have a fixed way of responding to situations or living in a manner which is of comfort. All right. However, in the long run, this is going to affect even people who are adventurous by nature and are risk-taking because of the controls that have come with this COVID-19 situation, one of them being the lockdown. All right. Another being wearing your mask. Another being following a lot of new instructions that are that we have been exposed to currently. Now, I would like to give a little example of this story, which is a classic story in a classic example and probably you've come across earlier in your life. Take 3 pots of boiling water, and when the water boils, in one pot, you could place in a potato. In another pot, you could place in an egg. And in another one, you could place in some coffee beans. All right. And let the water boil. What will happen to the potato, the egg, and the coffee beans? We all know that. The potato, which was hard, even the skin was hard, we need to peel it off. It will become soft and easy to smash and completely soft within. the egg, which has a softer core, all right, it will harden inside. But it is the coffee beans. Now, the coffee beans will exactly know in this situation, all right, how to blend. The coffee beans will blend in the water, all right. The water will catch the aroma, all right, and you know, mix in so well, and it will appear like, okay, this is smooth. I would enjoy this right now. So it is the coffee bean situation that we are in right now. We need to blend in with where we are today. This is the time where we have to blend in with the COVID-19 situation, adapt to the new rules, to the new instructions that have been given to us, because everybody is trying to figure a way out, and the only way out is the coffee beans way out. Now, so what do we do? Number two, the thumb rule for all is stick to the basics. Your stability rocks. And what is that stability rock for you? Number one, it's your daily routine. So a stable sleep pattern. Whatever before the lockdown and before the COVID-19 situation was your sleep pattern, whether it was, you know, waking up at 7 in the morning and going to sleep by 10 or 11, or if your work required you to wake up late in the night, you know, sleep late and wake up a little later, whatever has been your sleep pattern, consistently follow that. Keep it stable. Do not change it every day, all right? And when you do that, when you practice that, all right, you are following the step number one to your routine. Yes. So if you are used to watching Netflix, make sure that if you sleep by 11, your Netflix stops by 10. Give your eyes rest before you go to sleep. You know, stop using your phone 30 minutes before that. Listen to soft music. Yeah. And probably say your prayers before you go to sleep. And you will get a sound sleep, which will also help to keep your immunity intact, which will help to keep your emotions managed better. All right. The next is eat healthy, eat on time, eat nutritious food. This is the time, this is the hour we need to keep up with our immunity. Yes. And you can be an example for those around you if you practice this, because we all care for ourselves and our loved ones. So follow healthy eating practices, eat immunity boosting vegetables and fruits and the meats, whatever that is required, and practice your daily spiritual rituals. So whatever your spiritual rituals are, whatever your prayers are, whatever the timings are, make sure you practice them regularly, just like you used to do it before the COVID or the pre-COVID-19 times. So here is a beautiful picture of that reflects self-care. There is this boy doing the Pilates, the man having a sound sleep. If you see the family time, people are cooking together, you know, spend this quality, healthy time with your family, you know, clean your house together, cook together, sit together and eat, have healthy conversations discussing about how would you handle your finances, what are the cuts needed, what is required to be added, you know, how will the educational course take place in the future, what is the requirement of learning the adaptability for new technology. If there is someone in your family who is not very comfortable with technology, then, you know, expose them to that, teach them, yeah, show them that how you can use technology very, very effectively. So that is what you can do. Apart from that, sit together, you know, watch old photographs, you know, go through these old memories and feel happy about that. Have a nice, happy time with each other. Watch television together. You know, you can even create a routine where one day you are cooking and the other day there's someone else who's cooking. You know, one day you are cleaning and there's another day someone else cleaning. This will help you at a collective level to, you know, be more creative also and learn from each other also. You can also sit and play board games, card games, whatever that you feel as a family that you would enjoy, singing together, enjoying music together, watching movies together. So all of these are very healthy ways that you can add on into your self-care practices. Now, draw on to skills you've used before. So if you remember, I said that we're very used to uncertainties in our life. Probably the intensities are different. Situations are different, and therefore we are so used to and expecting that, okay, yeah, these things can happen, whereas COVID-19 is not something we had expected. So go back to these times of uncertainties that you may have faced in your life before, and check out how did you cope with them. You know, figure out these things, reflect on them, give time to yourself in a day where you can sit and reflect on these things, that what are all the healthy practices that you engaged in when you faced an uncertain time in your life, all right, at various intensities. The next is play to your strengths. Now, all of us have different strengths, and if we can play to these strengths, you know, we are actually making sure that we are filling in our what I call the pitara. You know, we're filling in with that, with more of knowledge in that particular respective area of our life. So if I have had cooking as a hobby, for example, this is the time where I can, you know, creatively explore and explore cooking. This is my strength. It gives me happiness. So I can do that. If I enjoy painting, this is my strength. I can sit every day at least minimum for an hour to sketch or paint and, you know, elevate the levels of my creativity and elevate the level of my strengths. Read books. You know, it's a very, very healthy practice for all of us to do. If we enjoy reading novels, be it fiction, non-fiction, whatever that you like, short stories, read books, you know, engage in something which is your strength. If you're good with all of y'all, most of y'all are engineers out here, so definitely y'all enjoy mathematics. So, you know, creatively engage yourself in activities where probably you can add on to your strength of quick calculations with abacus, or learning some other form of relative logistics. So, you know, engage yourself with that, learn new things, attend more webinars. We have online forums today to learn and update ourselves. So play to your strengths and fill your pitara, because you know, when these times will come to an end, we all will feel refreshed and somewhere down the line knowing much more than what we used to know. Now, there's something we need to monitor too. So if, yes, I said watch television together, learn new things for which we would need our laptops and computers. So it's very important in today's time. It's technology which is connecting you and me today. It's technology which is connecting our loved ones with us today. You know, we have not been managed to probably visit our parents if you're living somewhere else, visit our siblings if they are living somewhere else. You know, we are all stuck somewhere, but it's the screen time, it's the technology which is helping us. Now, very important that we monitor them. So how many hours in a day or how many minutes in a day do I watch television? Screen time, mobile screen time. I've said that before also. Stop the mobile 30 minutes before you go to sleep. You know, it's very, very important. So monitor it. You know, a lot of us are quite hooked to our mobile. We do all our work on the mobile. Shift it a little to your laptops. Shift it to a little to your computers. You know, if you're sending in emails, avoid doing it from your mobile. Because what happens is when you open that mobile screen to see an email, you see the WhatsApp, then the Facebook, then the Instagram, and everything. And you don't realize where the next 40 minutes passed by. Or maybe more than that. Time is precious, and we're losing it on a mobile phone. So it's something that, you know, you can engage yourself as a habit to limit your mobile screen times. laptops and computers, yes, they're very important. And I said, shift your mobile time to laptops. But however, here again, you need to monitor. Yes. So give yourself a number in your head that, you know, I know you're like engineers and probably maximum of your time requires to be sitting in front of your laptop screens. But still make sure that you make a limit in a day and make sure that all the other things that we've discussed are engaged, you know, in your hours. Very, very important. Engage these in your hours. The next is unhealthy eating habits. Monitor them. I know, you know, whatever is your favorite food, maybe a vada pav or a samosa or the Maggi noodles, eat them. There's no harm in eating anything, but monitor it, because these are times where we need to take care that we don't disturb the other parts of our body, all right, which are already getting disturbed thanks to the virus. You know, we all know how the mechanics here are working, I suppose, and therefore we need to keep that immunity up and we need to have those other organs functioning very healthy. So uneating healthy eating habits, please monitor them. The next is self-isolation. How many of you all are doing this, you know, sitting in a corner in your room and not wanting to talk to anyone throughout the day, just with your Netflix or your Amazon Primes or any of these? How many of y'all are doing that? So if you are engaging in anything like this, please, excuse me, I'm so sorry. Just give me a moment, please. I'll have some water. It's just about to sneeze. Yes. So, do not isolate yourself to this extent. How many of you all are avoiding talking to, or probably not just engaging in talks with your friends, your loved ones who are living away, to your colleagues? Make sure you remove time for that. Please make sure that you don't isolate yourself completely in this corner of your house and not wanting to interact with people. You know, take care of your emotional health by making sure that you give 30 minutes of a week at least, in the minimum that I could say, to the people, to your loved ones. Probably they are the ones who need to be heard and you are the one who can be available. So it's quite a give and take process out here, and please do that. Another thing is giving up on your possibilities and responsibilities. Monitor that. Now, this is something we may not even realize it. If you're not helping someone in their household, you know, start today. It is very much your responsibility to help the people in your house with these basic necessities of taking care of the house. You know, taking care of the fact that you have to wash your hands regularly, use the mask regularly. Very, very important. You're responsible for your health. When you will take responsibility for your health, you will take responsibility for the health of everyone around you. And when you take the responsibility for the health of everyone around you, by taking responsibility of your own health, you are creating a very high possibility that one day we can have a world which is free of COVID-19. I know this is something I'm talking which is very huge in your imagination. It's like, what are you talking? Is it possible? I say it is possible if we can be responsible. It is very much possible. If India could go get a polio-free country, yes, we made it possible. Let us also imagine in our minds that this too is going to be possible. We too can have a world without this virus. Now, there's something that I've added since we are now slowly getting back to work. I will personally share with you something that happened 2 weeks ago when at my place it was discussed that my husband said he would go back to work. And there was an entire moment of my life where I felt so anxious he wouldn't be at home. Yes, we all feel that. Yes, we are going to slowly get back to work. And of course, it was dealt with, and now he's back to work and it's all normal. But we can feel a rush of overwhelming emotions. And again, a very slight form of grief out here, because suddenly you are again going to be creating that space that you were so used to, you know. So those who are going back to work, they will not be seeing us throughout the day, and we will not be seeing them. And that is what life will slowly start getting back to. And therefore, with this unevenness, all right, because I will tell you, we don't know what will happen once everything starts. What if there's a second round of lockdown? A lot of questions in our head, right? So with all of this that is happening right now, we need to adopt an attitude. All right, and we need to be flexible. And what is this attitude? We need to practice the traits of being adaptable. And I would like to share something with all of you. So in Mumbai, a few days ago, there was this cyclone-like condition, and we were all asked to stay indoors and take care of our surrounding. And while I was sitting by the window, and watching the wind, pass by in rains around me, and the trees were swaying and swaying. And I was just looking at it, and it just hit me that, the tree which was two blocks away from my house, it broke down. So a lot of trees broke down. They were uprooted or they broke down. But this particular tree, all right, it was swaying, and probably it's, bended a little bit. But believe me, it's still there out there, okay? And that's when I said that, this approach of being flexible, because we're going to be swaying quite often now. We still don't know what model to adopt or going back to work, how things are going to turn out, all right? And the only thing that can keep us, very sane and very much in our place, and that's going to be being adaptable to our situation, all right? And let us see, what adaptability looks like. It is adaptable people change their action, their course, their approach to do new things in order to suit a new situation with effective actions and smooth processing. And look what we all have done, from regular classrooms to, actually having our classrooms right now via webinars and different platforms online, which would include Zoom, which would include Microsoft Teams, the Google Meet, where we are right now doing a webinar instead of probably a seminar in an AC hall or a classroom of an institute or a college. There's so much that we have progressed or altered in our everyday being. And I think very much what message has to be conveyed is still being conveyed. So yes, adaptability is the need of our, and that is what we are doing. Now, we have been doing this at our work level, but let us see, how being adaptable has been the core of us as humans. And let us figure out ways where we can use this approach, even in dealing with the coronavirus. All right. So in the past, let us see adaptability. The very core of it is Darwin's theory. If you see here, the human evolution from apes, as we have grown to use tools and further up and further up to bring possibly housewives to working women, or for men from farming to being in these offices where they are working and doing business, we have all evolved. We have also evolved as per the climate of the earth. So much has changed over the years and over centuries and centuries, so human evolution is the classic example to being adaptable. Let us see the other situations. The Spanish flu, which happened a century ago, and it affected a mass level of population. I think millions of people died back then, and yes, those who survived, we are here. Yes, so the Spanish flu is a classic example. The next is the very current situation. So that's what we were talking about, how during the virus we've seen a creative approach, we've seen an adaptable idea coming from Elon Musk, where Tesla decided to have ventilators being produced at mass levels instead of their usual machines of spacecraft that they make, and the other machines too. And he said that we do know how ventilators are made, and we do have the resources, and let us begin with the production of ventilators. And slowly it happened in India, in Gujarat, where a lot of ventilators are being mass produced. So yes, this is something which is called adaptability. Our doctors and frontline workers and healthcare workers have been doing that every day. Probably this medication will work, take care of your immunity, eat healthy, this will help you survive, have hot water, take a lot of steam, and if people are unaware, they're working extra hours. A lot of beds have been created. Classrooms have been converted into healthcare facilities to keep, the COVID-19 patients. Different approaches have been taken. People are going out to distribute food. Probably that was not a part of their work at all in the past, but they're doing that. So the old doctors have come back to work. A lot of new doctors have been asked to come at the forefront because it's the need of the hour. So yes, they're trying new things to save a life every moment. They've been spontaneous. Spontaneity, again, very important part of adaptability, So that is something, again, a very classic example. And then promotion. So this is something we've been dealing with in our regular life. You all have been promoted in life, from being children to being adults, of course, teenage in between. A lot of you all might be teenagers right now, from students to working, from your degree, your BA or your BSc, to your master's, to start beginning to work, to having positions at your workplace, getting leadership roles, to giving the responsibility to probably take in charge and becoming creative with your work, promotions and how we handle promotions. Yes, are we letting promotions go on our head, or are we evolving with healthy feedback from people that, listen, hey, I think it's time that that probably you're taking it in your head and you can calm down. And if I take this feedback well, yes, I'm being adaptable because I'm learning, and I'm learning at every step in my life. All right. So promotions are classic examples of being adaptable, from working under someone to taking in charge, being responsible. That is what promotions do to us. So here are certain traits, all right, that adaptable people adopt in their life. And they are probably doing it with a lot of ease. But the good news is we can all learn this. Yes. So be willing to try a new thing. Elon Musk did that. A lot of people did that, all right, when they decided to make ventilators. The next is, do not be afraid of failure. And, people who are not afraid of failure, people who are adaptable in nature, they take failure as not as failure, but they in fact take an approach to life, but they take risk, because they know at the end of the day, either this is going to be a hit or this is something I'm going to learn from. And then I will ask myself a lot of questions and be curious about what is the next thing I can do? What is it that I went wrong with? What is it that I have to alter in my way of functioning? Yes. So to not be afraid of failure, be creative and resourceful. Yes. So if you're going to be resourceful, you're going to have ideas, and the more the ideas you have, the more creativity is going to be possible in your life. So if, as I said, if you go back, that's what Elon Musk did, that is what the doctors are doing, that is what, you know, on promotions, you get opportunities to do, to being creative and resourceful. Doctors are really some of the most creative people. So are engineers, you know, because you all are doing something new every day so that we can get the best of the technologies, you know, the, in our day-to-day functioning. So being creative, being resourceful, all right, being curious, ask a lot of questions, be willing to change. You know, change is the only constant, and therefore change and uncertainty go hand in hand. All right, they're so parallel to each other, and we're so used to it, but yet we find ourselves so stuck right now. All right, so get curious, ask questions, be willing, and when needed, take a step back. So if something does not work for you, you need to wait, take a step back, reflect on everything. Again, ask the right questions. Am I doing the right thing? What is it that is missing out? What is it that is lacking? Is there something that I'm not able to understand? Take follow-ups, take feedbacks, ask people around you how you can improve yourself. All right. So this is a very good quality. And finally, be good with the situation instead of being against it, like the coffee bean. So this is your situation. And if you are going to be good with yourself by practicing all of the above things, bringing it in day by day, even if you haven't as of now, if you just try to at least put it into your life, you know, try adopting this functioning in your life, all right? Ask yourself, am I willing to? If I'm not, what is stopping me? You know, ask yourself, am I able to accept the fact that things have changed? If not, ask yourself, what is stopping me? Introspect, reflect, take a step back and get back, all right? Be with the situation. This is the R, and this R is of COVID-19. This is the R, and this R is where, you know, we are all facing a time of collective crisis. Yes, and all of us are here together today. All of you who are here together today, you're here to be with the situation. You're here because you are not wanting to be against the situation. A few more things.
Hello.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, madam.
Yeah. Okay. Do I continue or should I hold?
Selfie, please mute everybody's mic.
Yes. Should I continue?
Yes, madam.
Yeah, thank you very much. All right. Now, take care of your spiritual grounds. Practice the attitude of gratitude. So every morning when you wake up, you can thank yourself for being healthy, for having taken yourself till now, you know, and being where you are in the present. Thank you for, you know, your family members who are there around you. All right. They're all there, healthy. All right. Thank everyone who is important to you in your life, and probably whoever is there around you, and maybe they're not important to you, but they are there, they're living at a collective level with all of us. So express gratitude each day for every breath that you are breathing in and that you are exhaling out. Yes, the next is make forgiveness a very integral part of your life. You know, if you've been upset, angry with yourself, you know, very important first with yourself, forgive yourself. Yes, because we are all eligible to make mistakes, because we made those mistakes at first place because we believed in ourselves to do something. Yeah, and because we believed that that was right and we did that, and maybe it didn't work out for us. You know, so make forgiveness a very integral part of our life. Forgive those who are around you. Like we can make mistakes, so can they. Yeah, and for all you know, it can be misinterpretations, it can be misperceptions of situations. So make forgiveness a very, very integral part of your life. Practice empathy. Step into the shoes of others. And when you do that, see how forgiveness also becomes easier. Yeah, practice empathy. We are all feeling something. Some of us can handle, some of us can't. Yes, all you can do is listen without judging. Yes. You may not agree with someone, but you can definitely listen to them. So practice empathy. Empathy with your loved ones, be around for them, and see how at a collective conscious level, you know, we spread love and harmony and an environment of peace for all of us. So remember these few tips. Practicing these skills is the only way. So we don't have any other way but practicing these skills. 21 days makes for a habit. 90 days makes for a healthy lifestyle. Because if you know the science of how the neural system works, all right, a network is formed in our system. So if something is being done every day, if you practice it every day, it just starts becoming a network, a channel in your brain. And after a time, it's effortless to express gratitude, effortless for you to wake up at 7 or 6 or 10 every morning, whatever is your waking hour, effortless for you to sleep at the hour that you sleep at, effortless for you to exercise at the hour that you exercise, or eat at the time of eating, you know, your daily hours. Because your body, you know, remember, time is something, you know, which is a body has a clock, has a cycle. That is the time your body knows. It does not know the time that we see on the wall or on the watch that we have. But time is something which our body develops. Every cell of us develops a systematic approach to a timetable. You know, it just learns that. So practice this, remember this, all right? And see how your life becomes less distressing and much, much more easier and happier. Now, I would like to come to a story, the parable of the farmer and the wheat. This is the time when God and humans lived together on earth. And there was this farmer. Now, the farmer one day went up to God and told God that, God, you know what, you may be handling everything around in the world, which is amazing, but I would like to tell you something. You don't know anything about farming, you know. There is a way to approach farming, and we need a particular climate and a particular technique to conduct farming. So what you do is, you know, you give all the responsibility about farming to me, whatever is required for my fields and not. And you see what a great job I do and what a lovely yield and harvest of wheat I will have the next year. So the God says, tell me, what can I do? And he said, just give me these responsibilities. So God said, okay, fine. I'll give you the powers and you take care of it. So the farmer started regulating the climatic condition, the rainfalls, just the required amount, all right? The amount of sunlight required, the amount of water required, the kind of climate required. He started regulating. Everything seemed so perfect. And it was lush green. The yield looked amazing that year. But at the time of harvesting, there was no wheat grown, is what the farmer found. And he went to God and he asked God that, what just happened? You know, why has there been no yield of the wheat or no harvest this year? And God said, because everything was so perfect and there was no challenge to the seeds. And if you do not challenge a situation or a person, all right, or the conditions, you know, you will not have the best come out of you or something new come out of you. And this is what happened to your harvest. So we can all consider this current situation right now that we are facing in our life, all right, as a time which God has challenged us with, all right? this is a challenging time for us. It is not a bad time. It is a challenging time. We need to change this perspective, move from blame games and anger to a situation of understanding that whatever is happening around us, it is for a transition, all right? And therefore, all right, I go on to the next part, which is the part of our activity. This is the part which will help you connect with yourself at the highest level, you know. So you will be given around 10 to 12 minutes to do this activity, all right. You see a tree in front of you. You have a paper. You were asked to have paper, pens, and as an option, if you have colored pens, yes, you can use them. And I'm going to read out the instructions of what you're going to do. And I always believe that nature is our best teacher. I connect a lot with this particular activity or this particular thing of trees, you know, like from seeds to roots growing to a sapling to a plant to a tree to fruits and flowers to being hit by challenges, which are our storms. So there are a certain instructions given here with each part of the tree mentioned. And what you have to do is follow these instructions, spend time with yourself for the next 10 to 12 minutes and write down whatever has been mentioned here. So we have the roots that tells us about where we come from, what our beliefs and what our values are. You know, from birth till now, we have learned a lot from our immediate surrounding. All right, and we formed a firm value systems and firm beliefs in our life. So please write them down. The next would be the ground, your present life and the daily activities that you do. So currently what your life is like, what are your daily activities that you've been engaged in? That is what the ground is about. You can also mention all of your routines that was there just before the COVID-19 also. And check out whether, you know, it is very much the same or different. Then we have the bark of the tree, where you will mention your skills, your abilities, reflect on them, what your skills are, what your abilities are, you can write them down in depth if possible for you to reflect to that level. The next is branches, which is your hopes, your goals in life. Okay, so what are your goals? What do you hope for in life? The leaves, who are the important people in your life? The fruits and flowers, gifts from the important people that you've received. And finally, the storm, that is the challenges. So remember, this is a tree which has been hit by a crisis situation like COVID-19. And this is you. And all of this is your situation. Okay, so you're going to be timed, and it's after 12 minutes, to whatever extent that you can write, please write down. And you can also share, what the activity was like at the end on the message box. All right. So the next 10 to 12 minutes are for you for self-reflection and introspection. And all the best for that. Till then, we'll take a small break and I'll come back after 12 minutes. Thank you. The tree is going to remain on the screen, and all of you can have a look on the instructions that have been given to you. Thank you. The PPT is not visible, I suppose. I will reshare it. Just give me a moment, please. Can you see it right now?
Oh, ma'am,
it's visible.
Hello?
Yeah, it's visible now?
Yeah, it's visible.
Okay, fine. There's a message, I guess, where it's not. I'll put this back on the slideshow. Hello, Tehzeen, are you there? Risha,
yes,
hello?
Yes,
I think there are some messages which are saying the PPT is not visible. So I'll put it back on. I will just share it again with you all. Hello.
Nidhi ma'am.
Yes.
Basically, some people have not pinned the PPT on their screen. That's okay. Why it is not visible, basically.
All right.
And they can just see you. So tell, I want to tell everybody that if you pin your PPT, pin the PPT on your screen, it will be remaining over there. Because most of the people are seeing your face, not the PPT.
Okay.
It's visible.
Okay, I'll just put it again. I had stopped sharing the screen, so.
Hello everyone. I hope you all have completed the given task, and even if not, do not worry, you have the time to always get going with it. So yes, I will continue with the presentation. Please give your feedbacks about the task, and I have one question. I have one question for all of you. Which part of the task did you connect the highest with? You know, everyone feels a strong connection with something or the other, and this task has many factors associated to it. So which part of the task have you felt more connected with? Please make a note of that too. I'll be getting back to the presentation now. So moving on, so what is certain then? Remember at the beginning of the task, I had asked a question, is it possible for us to be certain? So we'll be coming to the point where we will be answering this. Yes and no. So what is the no? It is not possible for anything to be certain, but there are certain things, and there is something that can be certain, that we can be certain about. And this certainty is in the nature of things. Fire is always going to be hot. The nature of water is always going to be cool. Likewise, if we practice, you know, the things that we have spoken about under the stability rocks, you know, self-care habits, the traits of being adaptable as a person. If we keep practicing these things, then certainly these things can be a certain aspect of our life, a certain part of our life. All right. So the certain is being is in the nature of the things. All right. And in the same way, when you will follow all of the things that we've spoken about, all right, if you haven't done it till today, probably you must have spent this break, you know, wanting to sleep for more hours or something like that, then I know one thing, that being certain is in the nature of things, and you can begin now that it's being brought back to your awareness. Finally, if you feel overwhelmed, all right, after practicing all of this, if you still feel overwhelmed, if you still feel that lacking sleep, you know, you're lacking an appetite, you're having difficulty with socializing with people, then seek support. All right. So you can, since I'm a practicing counselor and I'm doing online counseling, you can definitely contact me via the email address that has been mentioned here, nidhipurana029@gmail.com. In case you're seeking for face-to-face counseling and you don't live in Mumbai, all right, or somewhere which is not close by to where I practice, you know, you can always send in an email to me, and I shall forward a directory of counselors to all of you across the country, and you know, wherever you know, you can trace in the nearby of your area, if you can find a counselor, and if they are doing a face-to-face counseling, you can contact them. So you can always email me, and I shall get back to you for the same. Now, as we are approaching the end of this PowerPoint presentation and this the webinar, I would like to read out a poem which has been written by a dear friend of mine. She's a writer, and her name is Gagandeep Bhatti. So here's a poem she wrote a few days ago on the current situation that we are in, creating hope in our minds as we read through this. So I'll begin right now. There will come a day when this all will be over. Some of us will walk out with joy, some with hope, some with fear, some with grief.
I have forgotten to put my earphones. I'm so sorry. Hello. I'm really sorry. I just missed out on the earphone this time. I hope you all have managed to hear what I was talking about. Can you please let me know, Tehsin?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you so much. Yes, I'll start the poem again. There will come a day when this all will be over. Some of us will walk out with joy, some with hope, some with fear, some with grief, and some with new beginning. Let it be known, they're all right. Don't judge, because we all survive the crisis on our own in unique ways. Some constantly worked front lines, some cried every night to sleep, some worried for food to come, some prayed for their work to begin. Some worked from home, some worked for home, some built deeper bonds, some repaired the toned down, some saw suffering firsthand, some saw with supporting stand, some felt it was unfair, and for some their loved one is not coming back. Some couldn't give last goodbyes, and some are devastated in tantrum of privilege. Some were gripped in loss and fear, some were choked with what the future holds. Let it be known, all fears, all feels are valid. What is important is the person besides is safe and alive. Pray for all, gratitude for what you have. Not too much to say, time to stand. Humanity has elevated. We know the fact. We are because we all are. When the dawn comes, believe you will be taken care of. New ways will be shown. New you will arise. When a day comes, when this is all over, you will live fully and love deeply. And if you can, hug tightly. Thank you, Gagandeep, for allowing me to share this beautiful poem with the audiences that I'm talking to today. I'm very happy doing that. And I found it to be really beautiful. I hope you did like it too. Finally, from me to you, a little piece, a little note from me to you. I hope in the space between loss and gain, you find healing, strong family bonds, and a time to revamp yourself. Take your first step now if you haven't yet. The much needed break is all yours. Thank you, everyone. Wishing you strength, wellness, compassion, peace, and abundance. Stay safe, stay healthy. And I would now allow Tehsin to take over. Please fill in the feedback form which has been given to all of you. And we would also like to take some questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Nidhi Burana. It was very informative and wonderful session. I am pretty sure it must have motivated our participants also to deal with this pandemic. Now we begin with question and answer session. Participants are requested to drop the question in the chat section below. I request Professor Vrishali Thakkar to take over the session for question answers.
Thank you, Tehsin. It was wonderful addressing to all of you. And thank you for the opportunity.
Hello, Vrishali madam.
So let's begin with the question answer session.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm here. Am I audible?
Yes, yes, I can hear you.
Okay. Let us start with the question and answer sessions.
Yes.
Participants, please post your questions in the chat box.
Yeah, there is one question, ma'am,
yes.
for you. Nidhi,
yes,
ma'am.
Yes, I'm listening.
Is there anything from which we can is there anything from which we can increase concentration power?
Okay. If you go through all the activities that I've given you, all right, when you exercise, when you eat healthy, all right, when you put yourself through a routine, so if you tell yourself consistently that this is what I have to do, you can also take help from people around you to remind you, all right, that please remind me that today, if I forget to do my exercise, push me a little when you are beginning to. Now, I'll tell you why I'm saying that eating habits and exercising, which also includes yoga and meditation, all right, very, very important that you inculcate these habits of exercising in your system, because when you exercise, your system releases some happy hormones, all right? Again, at the same time, your brain begins to develop, as I told you, a network, which definitely at all biological level elevates your ability to concentrate. So any of these exercising habits, which includes specifically, I would say, meditation and yoga, all right, will help you to increase your concentration. Another thing which will help you increase your concentration is telling yourself to stopping from distraction. So tell yourself stop when you're getting distracted in the middle of a lecture. It happens quite often that we end up judging the professor who's teaching us over their language skills, or if they make an error. So the content is not being taken care of, and you are distracted by the fact busy judging someone. So the moment you practice empathy and you practice listening, practice watching, all right, and these are all efforts you need to put. You have to keep telling yourself that, okay, listen, I need to listen, I need to see this, okay? If I'm getting distracted by others around me, okay, stop, okay? This is what I have in front of me. Let me finish this work off. Then I can always, think about all the other things. So concentration also improves with that. Reducing your screen times of doing Netflix and all the other stuff. All right. I'm not saying again that, completely stop it. But definitely watching more qualitative stuff will help you. All right. So concentration improves with exercising, healthy diet, and a few healthy self-talking habits where you can tell yourself from stopping yourself to doing these things. Does that answer your question, or you still have some doubt?
Oh, thank you, ma'am.
Yes.
Over to the next question from Tausif Saryan. How would someone maintain hope or positivity for a longer time in time of crisis? This
yes.
become practically very challenging sometimes.
Exactly. And this does become practically challenging. That is the reason, if you see through all that I told you in the slide, I have repeatedly told you, you need to consistently put yourself up to practice this and also be around to listening to each other. And when I say listening, not judging, all right? So you will get an emotional balance because there's someone listening to you and you're listening to someone else. Have the right role models. You can always add this up for yourself. The right role models in your life to look up to, who are living in a much more healthier way and are still ending up doing things. If you see, there are a lot of people in these times who have ended up making their hobbies their profession. You go through these Instagram pages and you'll see a lot of new businesses that have come up. People have got into their practices of painting and all of it. So when I'm saying again and again, getting your time utilized well by doing all of the things I've told you. And when I'm saying all, I mean all. It can be a little more tweak according to what your likes and dislikes are. So if you're thinking of exercising, one of you may think of doing yoga, another Pilates. If you're into strengthening and core workouts, you can do that, for example. So when I say engage yourself with your household activities, you won't know when the time ends. If throughout the day you split your day well enough, one to 2 hours for yourself, 1 to 3 hours for your family, and the rest of the hours doing your studies, doing your work that you're doing, which may be your college work, your office work, whatever that is, you will not know where the day has gone. And then eventually, an hour or so with your TV and your Netflix, and again watching quality stuff, even on media, not being just watching randomly anything, but seeking news from qualitative sources and qualitative channels. I think there will be no time for you to feel completely distressed, because you are so grounded when you are into your basic living. You will not get into these matters of feeling negative at all. And in the long run, for that matter. And of course, if still it doesn't help, then I've told you, seek help. Go to a counselor. Yeah, so is there anything you would like to... is your answer question... your question answered right now, or you have still a doubt?
We'll take a next question, ma'am.
Yes.
From Gindi, sir. Mm-hmm. Anxiety is all over because of lockdown.
Yeah.
What's way to get rid of?
Okay. So I would like to tell you that even if, of course, as I said, that anxiety is going to be there. Have you not faced anxiety before an exam or before a presentation or before your project being given out? You have. So anxiety is very basic in our lifestyle, because we all are thinking and we all are looking for giving the best that we can. We're looking for positivity, positive results in our life. So anxiety is going to be there. What you need to do is manage it, right? So if you're saying that, what can be done, it's just practicing all the things. And a very important point is healthy self-talk. So, time and again, look into your here and now. What do I have right now? Right now, in front of me, there is a lockdown. There is the coronavirus. There is my family. Okay? There is this family that, I have to look after. All right? And right now, this is what is there on my plate. Now, with this, what can I do? This is the resources what I have. I know to teach. Since you're a professor, so you are a teacher, I know how to teach. This is my area of strength. Now, if colleges have shut down, and if there is any issue related to XYZ, let's say finances, I'm talking hypothetically right now, wanting to finish your portion, all you can do is make the best utilization of your resources. This is the best thing you can do right now. Anxiety is going to be looming around. I also know that a lot of students are worried about their exams right now, because there's been this confusion regarding the fact that they were told there'll be exams, the final year exams, there'll be exams, and then no exams, and again there'll be exams. And this is something which is not in your control. This is something which is outside you. All you can do is be prepared. Be in the here and now. You have your books, you have your notes, you have your resources. Make use of it. You have the time to study. You have the time to make your projects. Make them. This is the best way to deal with it. Does that answer my question, sir?
Yes, I think so. So I must be satisfied.
Yeah.
Next question yes. From Nasheed. Mm-hmm. How to make kids cope up with corona scare? She yes. says, my kids have not stepped out from home since last
yes,
2 months.
This is a very good question. I'm sorry, I didn't get the age of your child. Can you tell me what's her age?
They are small, maybe seven, 8 years.
7, 8 years. All right. Now, I do not know what information they are exposed to right now. But number one, as parents, it's your responsibility what you talk in front of them and what kind of media you expose to them. All right. Because I relate to your question, and I will tell you, my niece, who's just 2.5 years old, happened to tell her mother, Mom, I don't want to grow up. I don't want to die. And from where does this understanding come to her? it's something when I was told about, I actually reflected over it for over a week, that what must have happened, because her mother is so careful about it. She herself is a teacher, and yet this kind of fear of death has come over in her head at such a tender age. You'll be turning 3 just in a few days. So a very good question. And for this, you have to, you know, go through the basic rules of parenting. Very simple, you know. Firstly, have healthy communication and talks with her. You know, since you said they must be 7 or 8. So, you know, tell them that, you know, in our life, we all come through situations like this, but fighting is the only way out. Now, they may not understand still. So for you, it is important that you start exposing them slowly to the outside world. So, you know, will you accompany me for a walk? You can take her for an early morning when there is a less crowd and there are less people around you. That is absolutely a safer time when you can go out, because normalcy have to return back. Make sure that the media content she's exposed to is cut out if it is negative, because the media these days is being really very repetitive and very negative on a large scale. I would not want to generalize, but it is very true that this is what is happening outside us, around us. So please make sure that, you know, what is she engaging herself with. Number 3, make sure that you create a routine for her. So all that I discussed with you, you can ensure this routine is also engaging with your kids. Put them through some online classes for painting, drawing, sketching. Sit with them, spend quality time with them, engage them with you for cooking. You know, maybe you can teach them how to cut in a creative manner. And that can be something they'll be engaged in. And, you know, the thinking will not be surrounded by the idea of death all the time. They will be surrounded with the idea of doing something about life. Give back the idea of hope to them. Yeah, a purpose to them. Give them a purpose in life. Yeah, ask them, what do they enjoy? Observe them. You're at home. You have more time to observe your kids. So observe them. What are their skills? What are they good with? Elevate those skills. Okay, engage them. If they're good with needlework, engage them in that. There's nothing wrong with it. You know, if they like painting, engage them with that. If they're good with math, engage them with that. You know, so when you will engage your children with healthy living habits and give them a purpose in this lockdown period, definitely after a point of time, this will all, you know, be understood by them, and you know they will eventually with time learn about the fact that this is a part of living and that time is over when it will be over. Till that, it's just the basic parenting that you have to follow and make them follow what you've been asked to follow. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes.
The next question is from Saili Gadekar.
Mm-hmm.
How to manage our emotion?
Beautiful. One of my favorite topics is managing emotions. I really, you know, think that this is our core, and we cannot really, you know, shun our emotions. We can't do that. So number one, I will not be going a lot in the depth of it. If you're a student of our college, I'm going to be organizing a workshop on managing emotions very soon, training on how to take care of it. But yes, emotional quotient, of course, is very important. Being emotionally intelligent is very important. So what we can really do for now for you to understand is firstly understand what your emotions are, and don't call them good and bad. Being upset or sad is not bad at all. So the moment if you say I'm sad and that's bad, you know, you have put your mind through a whole lot of negative thoughts, and you're not helping yourself at all with that. So you know, negative thoughts again are very, very normal to us. We have more than 60,000 thoughts a day. Now, you remember only those which are very important to you and which probably overtakes your emotions, right? So you need to, you know, go through an understanding of what emotions are. Identify your emotions first. The moment you're able to identify your emotions, you have to reflect on what you're thinking around it. And the moment you can identify those negative thoughts that you're thinking around that particular emotion, that's the time when you have to learn to manage that. So managing is an art, and that is a very in-depth subject which we can talk about in the near future if we can come up with something on this topic. Does that answer your question to a large extent?
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. The next question partially you had answered, but again, I would like to ask the question. For family bonding, especially with kids, what do you suggest since parks and play areas around many countries are closed?
Yes, correct. And that's a very, very sad situation when parks and all of them are shut or closed down right now. But what you can do is, as I said, that mindful training, you know, we get so stuck up with the idea of this is how my child can play, you know, teach them skipping at home. All right. That's a way of exercising. All right. Sit with them and make sure that a part of their day, you know, an hour in your day, in that day is spent doing qualitative learning as a part of their education. So whatever their age is, sit with their books and, you know, ask them to do something, maybe revise or, you know, expose them to more knowledge. All right. You know, in your entire day, make sure that they are also helping you with kitchen work, irrespective of them being a boy or a girl. Make sure that they are exposed to the kitchen life also. All right. Because we all love food and, you know, we all should be quite self-sufficient enough with ourselves that we know how to do every work around us. You can engage them in cleaning of the house. So at least begin with your own drawer. Sit with them, you know, show them how it is done. It's as simple as that. So I think going to parks is not the only solution. Of course, it would be amazing if they could, but you can definitely take them out for 15 to 20 minutes in a day at a time when they're not there's not a lot of public around. And of course, till they have the understanding that they don't have to run around over there, but they can just feel the fresh air. Because right now, the situation is such they need to be cognitively made to understand this thing, all right? That our situation is such that we cannot really be touching things around like we used to, right? But definitely a few hours down, and apart from that, come back home and in the household activities. Engage them with you. When you will engage, there'll be a better understanding and communication between y'all. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. The next question is from Adisha Vaish, ma'am. Grounding myself from anxiety is difficult for me when I fall sick. How do I deal with not overthinking about why I fell sick?
Okay. Now, why is the first thing? The very moment when you say why, all right, the question asked is very ambiguous. There's no answer to every why. All right. There's a possibility you exposed yourself to something. There's a possibility you didn't take care of your immunity. All right. So there can be many reasons. Now, once you fall sick, the first thing you do is you go to a doctor and you get yourself treated. Now, if there is a lot of anxiety coming to you because of you falling sick, you have to figure out the fact that there is a high possibility that you have not dealt with a situation in the past because of which there is a fear within you that how will I cope with it again? That's a very, very high possibility. Of course, may not be the reason, all right? But falling sick is, I would like to tell you this, is falling sick is something which is a part of our lives. You know, be it a malaria or a general normal flu or a normal cold and cough or you know, a fever. This is something we are exposed to in our life since the time we were born, you know, and it can happen to any one of us. So what questions you ask yourself, all right, is that is the number one thing, right? Because you need to change your narrative about falling ill, what you talk to yourself. You need to change that narrative. Your idea about what you understand about feeling sick. The moment you change that narrative, all right, you will find yourself handling that anxiety better. And of course, if that anxiety at that moment is very high, then number one, practice breathing skills, your pranayam, your breathing, you know, your breathing activities which are there. If you don't know, please learn them. Practice yoga. It will, and have water. You know, relax yourself. Sit down at one place. Take a glass of water. Take smaller sips of water. And first thing you do is bring your anxiety down. After you do that, you can ask yourself this question: where is this coming from? Okay, what is it that I'm talking to myself regarding being sick that it's making me so upset and so anxious? Now, when you have understood all this, then follow suit with healthy self-talks, affirmatives. There are a lot of other counseling skills that can be taken, can be used. But these are the basics that I can share with you right now. If you follow that, you know, you will be taking care of your anxieties. And still not, then you definitely need to, you know, seek help. Thank you.
Okay, going ahead, ma'am. From Sangam Jadhav, so many students are under tremendous pressure, especially last year students, because of decision and politics happening over final year exam. Exactly. Maybe directly or indirectly stressful for us. So how do we cope up with such scenario?
I think I've answered that in the past, but I'll say it again for you. Keep yourself prepared right now. Yes. Very important that you keep yourself prepared, because whatever the decisions will be taken, irrespective of the politics or no politics, you will be, you as in the, all the final year students, you all will be kept in mind that, you know, there is some result that comes out of it, whether you have an exam or whether you all are given your scores and aggregates, whatever that is, and whenever that is, of course, a decision will be taken. Right, it will not be in the air, hopefully, and I suppose it will not be. So what you can do is keep yourself updated with your knowledge, because at the end of the day, when you go out to work, apart from your scores, it is going to be about what you know. That will matter. So, you know, this is not something that, you know, it is a very individualistic case. It is a case which is being faced by on a large scale by most of by all the final year students, for that matter. So even when companies will be hiring, they are going to consider all these factors. They're not going to be like, oh, you didn't give your exam, so we are not going to hire you. It won't be that way. Yeah, so you keep yourself updated, you study, you keep everything ready. If you have projects given, assignments given, be ready with it. Whenever they come up with it, you should not be like, oh, I'm not prepared. Oh, if exams are happening, okay, fine, let the exams happen. We are going to go with it. Okay, if they're not happening, fine. I'm going to accept what is being given to me, because that's all you can do right now. It's not in your control. Right now, it's in the control of the administrators. In your control is only being prepared. So do that, and you will see that if you will do that, the stress levels will start going down. So focus on studying right now.
Rightly said, ma'am.
Yes.
Next question is from Nafisa, ma'am. In work from home life, how to balance work life and personal life?
Excellent question. Yes, create your boundaries. You know, be very clear with your communication with people in your house that this is what is there in my hand, and be very clear with the people you work with that this is what is there in my hand. Right. So I have work at home. I have to cook, I have to clean, I have to take care of my kids. They are around me 24/7 and I need to be there. Now you have to be clear with them that, listen, this is my work, this has started, okay? And this is also our bread and butter in a way. So I have to be doing that also. And you have to learn to bear with this, which means when I said, when you share your work, stress levels go down, because the amount of responsibility you have to take at the same time is no more the same time. It has been distributed. Yeah. So that is why I said, when you, you know, when you will engage everyone in the house, automatically you will be distributing it. But for that, communication is very important. You have to be clear with your colleagues. You tell me clearly what is the hour you would want me to be around. Sometimes it can be both you, husband and wife, are working. All right. And both your working hours might clash. Now, this is the time where, as colleagues, you'll have to be understanding towards each other. That's where your empathy skills will come in. Please be empathetic with each other. If one of your colleagues is saying that, you know, this is the situation, an extreme level, right? adjust your timings when you can have your meetings and give fixed hours, you know, that this hour of my day, I'm giving it to my work. So this is what I do. You know, the first half of my day is I'm with my family completely, like completely isn't completely. And the second half of the day in the evenings before dinner time, all right, I make sure I've made it clear. It's my counseling hours. I do my personal counseling over the call or over the video calls. And once that is over, then I get back, you know, to get all the residual work done. And in the end at night, probably I sit with all the extra work of preparations and stuff like that. So that is the only way you can manage it. So clear boundaries and clear communication, two things, and you are sorted. Yes, I've answered okay. That. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Now I probably feel that last two questions, it's similar.
Mm-hmm.
I'll share with you one question, which will be the last question, I guess. Okay. Most people lost their job because of COVID-19. Some are working, but are still not getting salary, mostly with private classes, even though they are conducting virtual sessions. What is the solution for them? Most of my friends are getting depressed because of the same.
Can you please repeat the first half? I'm sorry, I didn't.
I will repeat.
It's quite a long one. Please go slow. Yeah,
I will. Most people lost their job because of COVID-19.
Yes.
Some are working, but are still not getting their salary, mostly with private classes, even though they are conducting virtual sessions.
Mm-hmm.
What is the solution for them?
All right. As I told you all, if you've done it in the past, you will do it again. You have not got a job just like that. You have got this job because you have studied, you know, you have the skills, you have the abilities. You took the charge, gave that interview, all right? You may have been anxious even then before your interview, before your first interview, remember that. You know, go back to that time, but you took that risk. So even if things right now are not in your favor because of these unfortunate situations that we are all surrounded by, all right, this is not the end of your road. Yeah, you have done it in the past and you will do it again. When things will come at a standstill, when things will start again, you know, when there'll be a flow of money, you know, as I said, there is a problem where the economies are going down. And now that we're slowly coming back to life and there will be flow of energy around, okay? There are people who will come up with new ideas, new businesses, and new hirings will happen. They've happened in the past, they will happen tomorrow, today, and they will happen again, okay? So nothing is like it is forever, okay? We never thought we would be here. We thought what we were doing earlier was forever. We had all dreams and ideas of traveling and oh, it was all such a rush in life. Suddenly this standstill. No, none of us anticipated this. The same way, this will also pass. This is not forever. You know, like other things have passed, this will also pass. And with that, new ways, new creative ways will come out when new jobs will come up. Yes, you have to be patient. I understand the fact that you are going through a tough time. Emotionally, financially, and probably people around you are also upset. So socially, yeah, I definitely understand. But patience is all you have. What you can do right now is upgrade your skills in these hours. Yeah, there are webinars like these happening. There are more, you know, skill and ability based webinars that are happening. Or there are these people who have come up with the educational training. So upgrade yourself. Go back to your books. For some time, just don't think about the job consistently. I know it's a question which troubles you, but shift that, you know, distract yourself from that mode and go back to filling your pitara. Like I said, fill your pitara right now, because when it will start, there'll be a rush and you should be there up right there for the competition. Prepare yourself for that again. This is the best you can do to yourself. And if you can do that for yourself, you know, there's nothing like it. You've managed with, you know, 90% of the problem that is there right now. That's 10%, which is only the outside, which is in the external control that will have to be taken care of when things start coming up. And probably when you're sitting and upgrading yourself, you may come up with creative ideas and you might start something for yourself. So that's also a possibility and opportunity. And I think I very much have answered this question too for you.
Yes, ma'am, sure.
Yes.
Thanks for your answer, ma'am. Appreciate you answering all the questions of the participants.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Rushali Thakkar and Mrs. Nidhi Borana. Interesting questions answered perfectly. Now, if any participant wants to share any feedback, they are most welcome. We have received one message from Madam Salma Lokhandwala. First of all, I would like to thank Madam for attending the seminar on behalf of Training and Placement Department. Okay. Madam, we would like to hear, it's a request, if you can please unmute your mic and we will be happy to receive your feedback directly from you.
Thank you, Beta. Hello, good evening.
Yeah.
Salam, namaste. It was really, I would love to speak because it was really a wonderful session. I simply wanted to appreciate, this is a fact, because Madam, I would call it Nidhi, a madam, because she's a child to me. Nidhi, I don't know how to call you and how to address you, but you had been wonderful, wonderful psychologist who had removed all the darkness in the area, including my mind. There were many negative thoughts moving around my mind, but it was all clear. So many things. I really appreciate you. And all the questions were answered so beautifully, so satisfactorily. I'm sure the young generation, our young engineers, are just leaving this meeting with the very beautiful ideas of life. Yes, we have a beautiful life ahead. We have to believe in that. We have to be very positive. Nidhi, you have done a wonderful job. A magic today to change the personalities of all over here. We are really living with a very positive attitude. Thank you so much. I wish it would have been conducted a little earlier during these days. But anyway, it had been done. Such a pleasant personality. You were present over here and did a magic. Thank you so much, Nidhi. My love and regards and all the best wishes to you and the whole team of Sabu Siddiq and all the students present over here. Thank you very much. Thank you so much.
I would like to thank you. Yes. Thank you everyone for being a part of the session and listening to me.
Thank you.
And thank you for giving me this opportunity, ma'am.
Thank you. And thank you, ma'am.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Thank you for your address, Salma ma'am, also. Now I would take the honor of offering the vote of thanks. I would like organizing such event. I would like to express deep gratitude and hearty thanks to our speaker, Mrs. Nidhi Borana, for enlightening this webinar with wonderful session and motivational thoughts. Behind every successful event of Training and Placement Cell lies the manifold efforts of our Training and Placement Officer, Professor Shah Hussain Maghribi. He has been always a pillar of strength for all of us. I thank you, sir. I take this opportunity to thank you and your entire team of committed coordinators, Professor Khalid Usmani from Auto, Professor Atiya from Civil, Professor Ehlam Ansari from Computers, Professor Brushali Thakkar from Electronics, Professor Nabanita Chaudhary from Electronics and Telecom, Professor Sanam Kazi from Information Technology, Professor Bhaskar Gardas from Mechanical, and Ms. Tehseen Ravi from Training and Placement Sales. Last but not the least, I would like to thank all the participants for showing interest and for your support and for attending this webinar. We expect your support in the future events as well. Important announcement for all the participants. The link for the feedback is already shared in Telegram group and also it has been mailed to you at your registered email ID. All are requested to fill it and submit. You will receive your e-certificate shortly after submitting your feedback form. Please note, the link is active only till 6 p.m. tomorrow. I hope you all enjoyed. Thank you for attending once again. Thank you. The program is over. Hereby I declare it. Thank you.